Hi, good afternoon. It is my great pleasure to introduce Davide Scaramuzza from the University of Zurich. He's an assistant professor there. He did his PhD at ETH in Zurich, also Switzerland, and then did a postdoc at UPenn. He founded a company in Zurich, Zurich AI, right?
That's yes.
That recently got acquired and is now Facebook Oculus virtual reality lab in Zurich. So his work on visual inertial navigation is very impressive, and this is what he's going to show you today, in addition to work with Quadrotors and probably virtual reality also.
Maybe. Okay, thanks. Michael, for the introduction and also especially for the invitation. It's a honor for me to be here. So the title of my talk is going to be Towards Agile Flight or Vision Controlled Drones, from Active Vision to Event-Based Vision. And for those who are not familiar with event-based cameras, I'm going to tell you something about it later. The work I'm going to present is basically thanks to my students. This is some of my students, PhD students, but also undergraduate students. And maybe first I would like to present an overview of the research activities we do in my lab. So my background is basically robot vision. So I've worked for now 13 years in computer vision for robots. Initially I was working on autonomous cars when I was with Roland Sigvart. And then in 2008 I started working on drones, and basically on vision controlled drones. So we have a research area on visual inertial state estimation, how to use a combination of cameras and inertial sensors to do tracking and mapping. We try to also apply these algorithms on board, fully running on board drones. Here you can observe a drone basically flying along a circular trajectory. We also have a research line on dense reconstruction. So some of you probably are familiar with the work we did a few years ago on remote, where basically we try to triangulate every single pixel in the image in real time using a GPU. And then a few years ago, we started working on a new class of cameras called event-based cameras that are a new class of sensors that have a measurement rate of up to 1 million times faster than standard cameras. So you could, in principle, do one day visual slam at 1 megahertz. We also have another line of research on aerial ground collaboration, which you can see in this video. And last year, we also started working on deep learning, especially for end-to-end navigation, where basically we want to go from images to control actions. This was a joint work with Jürgen Schmidhuber, which was about basically running a CNN neural classifier to understand, you know, if there was a trail, a forest trail, in front of the drone, and then steer the drone accordingly so that it will follow the trail automatically. So what is my vision? So most of the research we do in my lab is driven by a vision, which is we want to send flying robots to the rescue. So you know, currently all the search and rescue operations that happen around the world usually happen beyond line of sight with the operator. So, you know, beyond line of sight, it means also that, you know, sometimes you lose the wireless communication with the operator, so you have to find ways to actually let the Quadrotor to operate completely autonomously without any intervention from the user. The problem is, in order to save lives, you have to be fast. So you have to be able to fly agilely in a collapsed, very cluttered, and definitely unstructured environment. If you want to visualize my vision, I found this very nice video on YouTube, which was made also by what became KML, what was KML Robotics, and then was acquired by Qualcomm. So it's a commercial from Lexus where you see about 50 drones. Some of those drones are real, other ones were CGI, so computer generated. But basically, you see here very well my vision. So ideally, in 5 to 10 years from now, I would like to have a drone that can move and fly so agile as the ones you see here. The problem is that as I'll try to convey within this seminar, it's actually very challenging. And it's not just a perception problem, but it's also a control and path planning problem. And actually, all the three of them are tightly coupled together. You need active perception, but you also need not just standard cameras, but also much faster sensors like event-based cameras. Now, in order to achieve this vision, one of the key ingredients for any vision-controlled or in general, autonomous device is localization. So how do you localize without GPS? So there are two ways to localize without GPS. Either use, for example, a motion capture system, or use onboard sensors. And here you can see the drone on the right-hand side is from my lab. So basically what we use is just a single onboard camera, looking down in this case, plus an inertial measurement unit. However, if we compare the two videos, the one from Vijay Kumar on the left and the one from my lab on the right, we can see that there is a huge gap between what you can achieve with a motion capture system and what you can still achieve with vision. So from the video of the aggressive flight through the window that you saw before, we can see that the drones have the potential to navigate quickly through unstructured environments, but at the moment autonomous variation is currently restricted to controlled environments. For example, a Vicon, or if you're using only onboard cameras, a very textured and very well illuminated room. Another problem is that vision-based maneuvers are still too slow and inaccurate with respect to motion capture systems. Why? Why is that? Well, you know, with a Vicon, you can actually execute a maneuver with the millimeter or sub-millimeter precision. But with vision, this is not the reality. So I think that perception algorithms are mature, but they are not robust enough. One of the reasons is because, unlike a motion capture system, the accuracy of a vision-based localization system highly depends on the distance. Actually, scales, it increases quadratically with the distance. And it also depends on the texture. And I will give you examples later. Another problem is that control and perception have been mostly considered separately. You know, in robotics, we have two communities, a computer vision community and conferences, and then, you know, robotics conferences. But very, very rarely, we actually see, you know, papers or researches that try to actually do control to improve the quality of perception, also called active perception. Another big problem in state-of-the-art system is that algorithms and sensors have big latencies, between 50 to 200 milliseconds. But we need faster sensors, especially for agile navigation. So based on these three problems, I structured the outline of this talk in three main research areas. The first one, I'm going to show you basically how we can achieve a vision inertial state estimation. I'm going to show you the state of the art and what we've done in my lab. Then I'm going to show you a few problems of active vision or that require active vision in order to be solved. And then I'm going to dedicate the remaining time to low latency event-based cameras. So let's talk about visual inertial navigation, visual inertial state estimation. So this is now, visual odometry is a 37-year-old research topic. The first work is probably Moravec PhD thesis that led then to the visual odometry on Mars in 2004. But basically, you know, there have been now many different pipelines. I would say that the most established pipeline now for visual odometry is what we call keyframe-based visual odometry, where basically, if you use a single camera, so this is called monocular visual odometry, you first bootstrap your point cloud from two keyframes, and then you localize every further frame with respect to the same point cloud using by solving a PNP problem, perspective from endpoints. But at some point, you realize that you're probably too far from the initial point cloud, so you want to initialize new key points, and you will call this frame a keyframe, and then proceed like before, so reiterate the same pipeline. So this is called keyframe-based visual odometry, and has now become the standard pipeline behind the state-of-the-art monocular open-source systems like OrbSLAM, LSDSLAM, OcVIS, DSO, and SVO. However, one of the crucial ingredients of all visual odometry pipelines is how do you estimate the motion between two consecutive frames. So there are two approaches. There are feature-based methods, and there are direct methods. In feature-based methods, what you do is that you extract points like corners or shift features. You match them. You probably apply RANSAC in order to remove the outliers. And then you try to estimate the motion of this frame with respect to the previous frame by minimizing the so-called reprojection error. But in the last 2-3 years, another method that was actually known for another 50 years became also very popular, which is direct methods. In contrast to feature-based methods, direct methods do not require the extraction of features. Instead, they rely directly on pixel. What they do is that basically you estimate the relative transformation by looking for the transformation that basically minimizes the per pixel intensity difference between the two images, or alignment error, which is basically here. This has been known since 2000, so for like 17 years, of course. There have been many, many papers, but never really applied in practice because we didn't have, the power that now you can find in all computers and also GPU. So that made it possible to actually track many, many pixels in real time. So what are the advantages or disadvantages of feature-based versus direct methods? So feature-based methods, they can cope well with the large frame-to-frame motion. However, they have a very expensive feature extraction and matching because you then require ransack, which is a very expensive procedure to remove the outliers. The advantages of direct methods instead is that since you can use as many pixels as you want, in principle all the pixels, well, because of information theory, you actually get higher precision and robustness. Additionally, if you increase the camera frame rate, the convergence rate is much higher. So, which is actually counterintuitive. The only drawback is actually that, they do not work very well with the large frame-to-frame motion. So they only work well with a very high frame rate. So when the baseline, so the distance between the consecutive frames is very small. So 3 years ago, we proposed an approach that basically takes the advantages of both, and we called it SVO, semi-direct visual odometry. Basically, what it does is that it combines features for keyframe-to-keyframe motion estimation by uses direct methods, and it takes all the advantages of direct methods to do frame-to-frame motion estimation. Now, the next question that comes is, when you want to use direct methods, what is the right amount of pixels that you want to use? So now, if you are familiar with the state of the art, there are three different schemes. There are dense methods, semi-dense direct methods, and sparse direct methods. In dense, you are basically tracking every single pixel in the image. So if you have a VGA image, you are tracking about 300,000 pixels, which is quite expensive, so they will require a GPU. So popular methods are DTAM and Remode from my group, which is also open source. Otherwise, actually, it's been found that you don't need to track all the pixels in the image, but rather you can just focus on edges, so on high gradients, because they are very informative. And then you would have semi-dense approaches, like LSD-SLAM. In average scene, you have about 10,000 pixels to track. In SVO, what we do instead is that instead of tracking every single edge pixel, we only focus on a few sparse pixels selected from edges that are corners or edgeless, so segments of edges. So, and because in SVO we are tracking between 100 to 2,000, so 200 patches, and each patch is 4x4 basically pixels, we are tracking on average around 2,000 pixels per frame. So notice basically the tremendous gain in computational cost. So we are 5,000 faster than this, for example, in number of pixels. But now another question comes. I told you before that direct methods do not cope very well with large frame-to-frame motion. So here what you can see is the robustness to the distance between consecutive frames. Here, actually, you see the convergence rate as a function of the distance between the frames for dense, semi-dense, and sparse. And what you can notice is that actually there is not much difference, as I was telling you about, between dense and semi-dense approaches. There is no gain, because in the end, what is really informative is the strong gradients. So probably, and this is actually an argument, because there was never a paper that tries to evaluate that, probably dense methods are useful with when you have motion blur and defocus. But what about sparse methods instead? It seems that they perform a little less than semi-dense and dense. This is true if you go for very large frame-to-frame motion, but as you can see here, if you have up to only 30% overlap between consecutive images, which is a lot already, you actually get the same tracking performance as semi-dense and dense methods. So I hope with this I convince you that basically if you have a very high frame rate, there is no gain in using semi-dense on dense methods, okay? As long as, of course, you don't have motion blur and defocus, but this is, I would say, it's a problem also for other things. So here is basically a video that shows the performance of SVO on different data sets. Here you can see basically SVO running on a drone that is basically flying in a factory environment. So basically you see the corners being triangulated, and this is done incrementally, frame after frame. SVO is very fast. Here it's also on the Kitty dataset, so it can run up to 400 frames, 50 frames per second on a laptop, or even up to 70 frames per second on a smartphone processor like the Odroid. Another interesting feature is that it's probabilistic. So we estimate the depth uncertainty for every pixel that we track. And this is done on CPU, not on GPU. And this is very important because in robotics you care when you want to use a SLAM pipeline for localizing and for controlling a robot, you don't want to crash. So you want your map to be very accurate. So it's very important that you estimate the uncertainty. Now, okay, so far I've been showing you how to do basically motion estimation using a single camera, but now how can we combine a single camera together with, for example, an inertial measurement unit? Why would we even need to do that? Well, the main reason to do that is because with a single camera you don't get the so-called absolute scale of your map. So your map could be 1 mile or 50 kilometers, you wouldn't know unless you use an additional information like, for example, accelerometers and gyroscopes. But now the problem is, how do you fuse the information from IMUs with the camera? So there are two problems to solve. So visual odometry provides you the position x up to an unknown scale factor s. Instead, from the accelerometers, this is the bias, this is the gravity, if you double integrate the accelerometers, you get the position up to an unknown initial velocity. Now, what most systems do is that they initialize the V0, assuming that it's at rest, like, for example, Google Tango and other systems. However, there have been now the literature is full of different methods, and here I try to summarize in one slide the last basically 10, 15 years of research. So we can divide the systems of monocular visual inertial fusion on four subtopics. So the first one is closed form solution. So there was a guy at INRIA in France, Agostino Martinelli, who actually came up with a closed form solution that is able to estimate the scale factor and V0 with just using the pseudo inverse. So it boils down to basically a linear system of equations. And then you can use this initialization to actually initialize other methods like filter-based approaches or optimization-based approaches. So typically most of the initial work on vision inertial fusion has been done on filters. However, filters typically only update the last state of the system, which makes them fast. But the problem is that the number of them, the covariance grows quadratically with the number of features. So typically what they do is that they track only a limited number of features, like 20. An alternative has been to work on optimization-based approaches like fixed lug smoothers or full smoothers. That is, what they do is that they either optimize a window of frames or the whole history of frames. So we have done a contribution in this 2 years ago with the joint work with Fran Dellert and Luca Garlone, where basically we try to solve the problem of vision inertial fusion as a post-graph optimization problem, where basically we try to you see, the red dots are basically the IMU measurements, the positions obtained by double integration of the IMU, and the gray triangles are the positions of the cameras. And we try to basically solve this problem by optimizing. The problem consists in minimizing basically the IMU residual, so the error between the position estimated by the IMU and the position estimated by the camera, and the bundle adjustment residual, so the reprojection error. The problem was that typically solving this optimization problem takes a lot of time because the graph is very dense. So we sparsified the graph, and basically by summarizing several IMU measurements into a single post-constraint, which we call pre-integrated IMU factors, and then we typically solve this using, for example, factor graphs like ISAM that Michael Kess pioneered here in this room. So this made the algorithm very, very efficient. You can run it at 50 Hz and optimize the whole history of frames. Also because GTSum actually has this very nice property that only updates the states that are affected by a new measurement. So this made also the system competitive against Google Tango, for example, that was considered the best so far. So here you can see the translational drift versus the travel distance. And you can, so our proposed approach is the blue one. And you can see, and the Tango, Google Tango is basically the red one. And you can see we perform better than Tango. But the reason is because Tango is using a filter, an extended Kalman filter. So they only update the last pose while we are updating all the poses on the system. Now I want to show you some results where basically we integrated this research results into our drones to achieve autonomous vision control navigation. So this is one of our drones, it's custom made. This is our main sensor, it's a global shutter camera, up to 90 frames per second. Then we have a PX4 autopilot, which was from ETH Zurich. And then we use an Android processor, which is basically the same processor you find in Samsung Galaxy series, to run all our vision control and path planning algorithm. They all run on board on two of the four cores of the CPU. So it's pretty light. And also the whole system is very light. It's only 450 grams. So here you see four videos of our performance. First, I want to focus on hovering. So the camera is looking down. The Quadrotor is hovering at 1.5 meters from the floor. You can see that we reach a position error of 5 millimeter. So basically, you know, quite competitive like with the Bicon. Of course, Bicon can reach up to 1 millimeter. Here you can see the same system are now following a pre-computed trajectory, an 8-shaped trajectory, flying at 4 meters per second at the height of 3 meters. All vision-based, all running on board. Here you can see the features. You can see they are not really affected by the reflections of the sunlight. Of course, they would be affected, but in this case, actually, they was pretty fine. So it depends on the illumination conditions. Here you can see the robustness of the system against the dynamic scenes. For example, here I asked my student to possibly lay on the floor and then start moving below the Quadrotor. But as you can see, the Quadrotor did not get disturbed by the motion of the student because most of the features are coming from the static part of the scene. And remember, we are using this probabilistic depth estimation, so we can be sure that if points are added to the map, they must be very good. Here is another system where basically we devised a method to automatically recover from an aggressive flight, like from after launching the Quadrotor, tossing the Quadrotor in the air. And this is basically only using, again, onboard sensors. So a camera, an IMU, and in this case also a single pixel distance sensor, but not GPS. So we started doing all these things about 5 years ago. And so we have had also the luck to collaborate with some companies in Switzerland or outside Switzerland. So I want to show you some applications of this. This was a project, 2-year project with the company Parrot Sensefly. Sensefly was acquired by Parrot 3 years ago. And basically, we transferred some of these vision-based control algorithms to this system, to this Quadrotor that has 5 cameras and 5 ultrasound sensors. It's meant for inspection of autonomous inspection of bridges, dams, power masts, and power lines. Another company that we transferred our algorithms is Dacuda 3D Division, which was acquired last week by Magic Leap. And basically here, this is what they showed at CES in Las Vegas this year. Basically, they were using an iPhone 7 camera, and the SVO was running on board on the CPU to basically do fully immersive virtual reality. And the other thing was, this is a Zurich Eye, is as Michael was saying. It was a spin-off from 3 members of my lab, the inventors of SVO and Remode, who actually created this venture. And after 1 year, so they were working on trying to commercialize vision inertial solutions for mobile robotics. And after that 1 year, basically, they became part of Facebook Oculus Zurich. OK, so far, all the results that you've seen on our drones were relying on pre-computed trajectories. So typically, we, the user, were telling the drone what to follow. And then they would basically use onboard vision and control to execute these maneuvers as accurately as possible. Now, what I'm going to try to talk about here is that for many things, you would actually need active vision. What is active vision? So active vision, first of all, the term active vision is very old. The first paper can be traced back to 88 by Rosina Bacci. That is called active vision or active perception paper. But basically, she defines active vision as the problem of optimally controlling the camera parameters that can be internal or the motion of the camera in order to improve the quality of perception. Now, you can actually adapt this definition to the problem you want to solve. For example, for me, what I want to do is that I want to compute the best trajectory from A to B, or I want to, for example, compute the best map of the environment that minimizes the motion blur, but also that favors texture-rich areas. Because one of the crucial problems in vision control navigation is that it will never work on areas that are poor of texture. So you have to select in advance which areas are texture-rich and then try to follow them and favor them. The problem is that most works in the state of the art on active perception, they retained, they only used the geometric information, but they were not using basically the scene appearance. So what, yeah, we just showed this slide about it. But basically what we have done, we have investigated in the last couple of years, is the effect of different types of texture on the motion of the robot, depending on the task. For example, if the task is to best reconstruct the scene underneath the robot, well, look, if you are moving over an isotropic texture, there is no privileged motion. Anything is fine. But if you move over a non-isotropic texture, like a dominant gradient direction, like a grain field, you can see that the covariance, in this case, we are plotting the covariance of the pose. Well, you can see if you move parallel to the stripes, you don't get any information. So you would rather move perpendicular to the stripes. So interestingly, when we implemented this on the quadrotor naturally tries to move perpendicular to the stripes. We also did another experiment, which I don't have time to show you here. With an isotropic texture, the emerging behavior is a circle. Another thing that we are investigating is how can we do planning under uncertainty, but by computing the uncertainty, not just using the geometric information of the scene, but also the appearance or the texture of the scene. Because most path planners compute the best path from the start to the goal, trying to minimize the time, you know, but the uncertainty is typically computed based on the geometry. While instead, if you favor texture rich areas in the scene, of course, you get a slightly longer path, but actually with better accuracy. So you should actually sacrifice, you know, a bit of time in order to follow trajectories that favor texture-rich areas. So that's one thing, that a message I would like to convey. And as you can see, the covariance of the pose depends quadratically on the distance and on the gradients of the image that you are observing. I want to now show you another active vision problem, that another task, which we have been working on for 1.5 years, which is how can we fly a quadrotor through a narrow gap like this? So I have to say this was an obsession that started in 2011 when I was a postdoc with Vijay Kumar and Kostas Danilidis. Who has seen this video before? Yeah, many of you. So this was fantastic. So this video collected like 8 million views on YouTube. And since then, I basically said, I would like to do this with the onboard vision. So the paper was about path planning in the SNAP domain. However, we have to realize some things, some problems. So the robot, remember, was blind. They were using a beacon. So therefore, it does not see the window. And it had to follow a precise trajectory. Otherwise, it would have collided with the window. And the beacon ensured that it would follow this precise trajectory with millimeter precision. Now, how difficult is to do this with a vision? So I challenged the two Swiss FPV drone pilots to come to my lab and pass through a narrow gap. And you're going to see this here. So we took a gap, say a mock-up of what we wanted to pass through, and we challenged them to pass through it. Oh, yeah. We also increased the inclination of the gap. So this is one of the pilots that were wearing these wireless goggles. And now, after a few attempts, they basically managed to pass through it successfully. But notice that actually they are taking a very long runway in order to pass through it, OK? So this is what a deep neural network can do. Let's see model-based approaches. How would they perform? So we wanted to do with the vision. So the assumption is that we have a window detector, gap detector. To facilitate the task, we use a black and white window. And then we use the simple algorithm like the OpenCV function PNP to compute the pose of the camera with respect to the gap. And then we fuse this with a camera filter within IMU. So we had a window plus IMU state estimator. So we apply the same algorithm of Kumar, 2011. We compute the position and orientation of the quadrotor with respect to the gap, and let's see what happens. The quadrotor is here. What happened? We were only estimating the pose of the quadrotor with respect to the window at the very beginning. right? We were not replanning this. We were not trying to reobserve. You know what the accuracy, the uncertainty was at that, at 3 meters? It was about 30 centimeters accuracy along X and Y, and even worse along Z. So there is a perception problem, which is, you know, the post-uncertainty of any vision, especially monocular vision, system increases quadratically with the distance. So there is a big challenge, because not only you have to cope with the post-uncertainty that varies, so it actually improves as you get closer to the window, but there are also other constraints that you need to satisfy in order to pass through the window. The first one is the dynamic constraint. You want to maybe be continuous up to the jerk and minimize the snap, so the energy. Maybe you also want to stay within the center and pass through the gap perpendicular to the window in order to minimize the probability of collision. But more importantly, you want to include your perception constraints. You want always to face the window in order to enable localization with respect to the window, because if you don't see the window, you don't know where you are. And you need to do this, because at the beginning, your uncertainty is 30 centimeters. By doing this, you are implicitly also reducing the motion blur. So actually, you don't need an event camera to do this. But a standard camera is fine if you plan on purpose a trajectory to do that. But you continuously have to replan in order to cope with a varying pose uncertainty. So with that, now I just show you the final result. We basically managed to do that.
We present a method.
And here you see basically the quadrotor also in slow motion. So we have we generate two different trajectories. The first one tries, of course, to make sure that the window is always in the center of the image, and all the corners are visible in the image. When you are too close to the window disappears. So you have to initiate a trajectory that does not require visual feedback. And the only one is basically by ensuring that, for example, all the propellers spin at the same speed, so you lay on a plane perpendicular to the quadrotor. Another thing is that we also try different inclination up to 45 degrees. Beyond 45 degrees, the motor saturated, so we could not do that successfully. However, up to 45 degrees, we reached a success rate of 80%. Of course, 20% of the times we crashed quadrotors and we broke propellers and arms, but they were easy to replace. Another thing we had to do is that during this maneuver, you generate angular speeds up to 800 degrees a second, which means you actually need to tilt the propellers, and we tilted the propellers by 15 degrees while losing only 3% of efficiency in thrust. But by tilting the propellers, you actually provide three times more yaw control action, so you can actually accelerate much faster. So I hope with this, you know, with this flight through narrow gap and the other two examples, I convince you that you need to do active vision for many problems in robotics. And now I would like to focus on the latest topic that actually is, for me, very exciting. It's called a low latency event-based vision. And it's basically, you know, the work that centers around using a new type of sensors called event-based cameras. So why do we need an event cameras? If we need event cameras? So currently, if you think of flight maneuvers achieved with the onboard standard cameras, as I told you before, they are still slow compared with those attainable by, for example, a Vicon or an FPV, or even worse, by a bird. What you can see here is a bird, actually it's a sparrowhawk, catching a garden bird. It's all in real time. It's all in 4 seconds that it's doing this. Okay? So there is a problem of latency. What is the latency? So the agility of a robot is limited by the latency and temporal discretization of his sensing pipeline. So the latency, basically, in a standard camera is the time you need to process the last frame. And the temporal discretization is basically the frame rate. It's the time that you need to wait until the next frame arrives. The average robot vision algorithms nowadays have latencies between 50 and 200 milliseconds. You know how much is the constant time of the actuators of a quadrotor. A good quadrotor has a constant time of 30 milliseconds. So you are right above that. But you know, 10 years ago, drones were like this. Now they are like this. And in some markets, you can already buy toys like the Crazy Fly that are like this for $10. What is the trend of drones? We are scaling down. You know the project RoboB at Harvard, led by Robert Wood, about building a robotic bee? So we can imagine that in 10, 20 years from now, we will have drones of this size, with probably latencies of their wings or propellers that will be below a millisecond. So my vision is that I want to basically do research that could also be used, you know, can already be used already for low latency applications, but it could be even more useful for applications where basically latency is even more crucial, like below 1 millisecond. So the main question is, can we create a low latency, low discretization perception pipeline? And the answer is yes, if we combine cameras with event-based cameras. So who is familiar here with an event-based camera? Okay, so a few of you. So think of the human vision system. In each eye, we have 130 million photoreceptors, cones, and rods, but only 2 million axons. So axons are like wires that connect the photoreceptors to the brain. How is it possible we have many more pixels than the effective number of axons? This is possible because our human eyes are actually, they have photoreceptors that trigger information to the brain, not all simultaneously, but rather asynchronously. Actually, you know, every time that a few photons hit a photoreceptor, the photoreceptor sends a signal to the brain. Now, inspired by this biological working principle, Professor Toby Delbruck at ETH and University of Zurich in 2008 built the first commercial event-based camera, which is called Dynamic Vision Sensor, or DVS. This is the reference paper. Basically, a DVS has a temporal resolution of 1 microsecond. So in principle, one day, it should be possible to do SLAM at 1 megahertz. It has also a very high dynamic range, 130 decibels. Just to give you an idea, this is 7 orders of magnitude superior to standard cameras, to good standard cameras. This means that these cameras can see very well in the moonlight or in a bright sky. For example, this is a picture taken with a DVS during the solar eclipse in 2015 without a black filter. So here we're actually moving the fingers in front of the DVS, and at the same time, we could see both the fingers and the edges of the moon. I'll tell you in a little bit what these points are, but this is what the camera measures. Another cool thing about this sensor it is very low power. It only needs 20 milliwatts instead of 1.5 watts of standard cameras. How does it work? So all the pixels of this sensor are independent of each other, and every time that a single pixel detects a change of intensity, it triggers an event to the camera. So an event is basically a data structure that contains the timestamp, the X and Y pixel position, and the sign of the change. So it does not record the magnitude or the change, but only the sign, positive or negative. So you only need zeros and ones. So it's a binary output per pixel, binary stream. Let's try to visualize this with an animation. Let's assume that you have a disk with a black dot. Remember, a DVS, it's only sensitive to changes of intensity. So if you don't move, nothing will generate events. So let's rotate the disk. A standard camera, we know, it would output frames at constant time intervals, but a DVS will output a spiral of events in the X, Y, and time domain. Is it clear? The cool thing is that if nothing moves anymore, no events are generated, which means you have a drastic reduction in bandwidth. Another cool thing is you have no motion blur. You know, in standard cameras, you have an exposure time. Here, you have no exposure time. This sensor works in differential mode. So this is one way to visualize the information from a DVS using a three-dimensional signal. The other way is actually to accumulate events happening in a certain interval of time. For example, here, 40 milliseconds. But you can go down to 1 microsecond. The color encodes the polarity of the change, the sign of the change, positive or negative. And if nothing moves in the scene, which you will see, you only see background noise, but it can be modeled. Notice that basically the sensor acts as a motion-activated edge detector, right? Because in the end, you know, what is triggering events is changes of intensity, the natural response, you know, to edges. And notice also that, you know, points, you'll see in a little bit again, points that are farther generate less events than points that are closer to you. So we can already see that there is a relation with the apparent motion or optical flow equation. So what are the advantages? The advantages we already talked about: low latency, high dynamic range, low bandwidth, low power. But there are some disadvantages. The first one being that basically it requires a paradigm shift in order to be used, because basically you cannot apply any of the vision algorithms that were developed for the past 50 years in computer vision, because the output is totally asynchronous and it's also binary. There is no intensity information. Another problem is actually the resolution is pretty low at the moment, 240 by 180 pixels. Just to show you, I see that I have more time, so I want to show you this slide. Behind each pixel in the DVS, you have a set of comparators. Say that this is the light intensity at the top of this photoreceptor. This is now how the DVS really works per pixel. So every time that there is a relative change of intensity that is superior than 10% from the previous event, then you have a non-event. If it's less than this 10%, you have an off-event, so on and so forth. And you can see that the output is totally asynchronous. But you can also see that in principle, if you integrate all this over time, you could reconstruct instantaneously the intensity of the signal. So people have done it. The first one was in 2011 from Matthew Cook. So you could, in principle, do Poisson integration and reconstruct the whole intensity, absolute intensity of the signal. But maybe you don't want to do it because otherwise you are accumulating latency. So in 2014, we actually, one of the first things we did when we started playing with the DVS is to mount it on a drone and start doing record data sets during aggressive maneuvers, like, for example, a flip. Why a flip? Because during a flip, you actually rotate at more than 1,000 degrees a second, so it's really fast. Just to give you an example, if you do like this, it's 500 degrees a second. So that's really, really fast. Here you can see that the standard images will be affected by motion blur, while the DVS integrated image looks very sharp. But it all depends on the accumulation time that you're using. So let me show you this for different integration times. From 33 milliseconds down to 0.1 milliseconds. But remember, you can go down to 1 microsecond. But then you would only see noise, so I'm not showing this. So what is the best time window to use? So the problem is that if you use a certain time window, actually you are increasing the latency of your system, and that's not what we are interested in. What I'm interested in is in doing event-based vision. So we want to estimate the state of the system, for example, event by event. So, but as you can see at the beginning, we were doing this with very simple sceneries, like, for example, you know, a black shape on a very clear background. So we wanted to move away from artificial scenes, and therefore we had to model basically the triggering model of a DVS. So this was published in ICRO 2014 with Andrea Scienzi from Emilio Frazzoli's group. Basically what we claim here is that you know, if you have a very simple scene consisting of a simple edge between a black and white, intuitively, if you move the DVS parallel to the edge, no events will be generated. But if you move it in any other direction and ideally perpendicular, you will have maximum generation of events. So intuitively, the probability that an event is generated should be depending on the scalar product between the gradient, which you don't know, and the apparent motion or optical flow, which also you don't know, but you want to estimate. And then what we do is that we try to estimate this with Bayesian methods. So the first work we did try to do that assuming that we have already built a map. For example, in this case, we used a poster. Easy to build the map of a poster because it's flat. And we implement our Bayesian localization. So here we are comparing two pipelines, one running SVO on the input of a standard camera, and then running our event-based pipeline on the input of the event camera. Here in slow motion, you can see the SVO fails when it starts observing motion blur, while the event-based camera is not affected by motion blur, because the motion is very slow. However, also notice that during the time that basically they could both track the motion, the accuracy between the event-based visual odometry and the standard frame-based visual odometry is actually comparable, although a DVS has 20 times less resolution than a standard camera. How is it possible we get the comparable accuracy? It's because we have a much higher temporal resolution. So that one can compensate for the loss in spatial resolution. Of course, now the next natural thing to do is mapping. So last year we came up with this BMVC paper about mapping. And since it's strongly inspired by multi-view stereo, because there we assume we know initially the trajectory, we called it EMVS, or event-based multi-view stereo. The way the system works is very similar to standard dense reconstruction approaches or plane sweeping methods, where basically we have a voting array where in each cell of the array we sum the contributions of the projected rays corresponding to every event. And we manage to do this event-based. So in the end, what we managed to build in real time is a disparity space image in a 3D array that intuitively is showing you what is the real structure of the environment, because the structure of the environment is the one that corresponds to sharp or high density regions in this array. So what we do is that we do adaptive thresholding in order to find a map out of it. Then what we did is that we integrated mapping and tracking, and now I'm going to present you what will be presented at ICRA this year, is what we call EVO, event-based visual odometry, or 6DOF parallel tracking and mapping. This can run both in real time on both a laptop or a smartphone processor, not GPU, just purely on the CPU. As you can see, the map that you built is semi-dense because the DVS, again, responds naturally to edges, so you get them on hardware. It works again well with, you know, with abrupt motion like this. Here we also use a beacon to track and compare against ground truth. Here we are showing you events only. Again, blue and red encode the different polarity of the events. This is also an image from a standard camera for comparison. I show you this other sequence where basically now we have a multi-keyframe sequence, and now we turn the light on off. As soon as they will be turned on again. This is a typical HDR scenario that make all the standard camera-based systems fail because of the abrupt transition of light. You know what it means for a DVS when you turn off the light? All the pixels will spike within a microsecond. So you see, you actually observe a glitch, but you can filter it out and then basically continue tracking as if nothing happened. Okay? In addition to that, what we managed to do now is also we can to estimate the intensity of the image, although it's not necessary by the algorithm, we can do this in real time. So if you know the motion of the camera, you can do Poisson integration and get from the gradients you are estimating, you can also get the intensity signal. Here we also project the events on the top of a standard image for comparison, for qualitative assessment. And finally, I want to show you this interesting sequence where basically we are comparing, we are actually running EVO against the bright sunlight. This is an image from my iPhone that was rigidly attached to the DVS with a tape to show you that basically, you know, in a standard image, you would have, you know, part of the image would be overexposed or underexposed. This is what the event image looks like. You see, all the other events are not disturbed by the, you know, the sunlight, and we managed to continuously do tracking as if nothing happened. Okay, I think this is I hope it convinces you that basically here there is a huge potential, okay, of event cameras, you know, with respect to standard cameras. Ideally, you would like to combine both. And that's the point, to the final point, that the final research we are working on now. Wouldn't it be great if there was a sensor that integrates a standard camera and events in the same chip, in the same array? So the sensor exists since 2 years ago. It's called the Davis from the same guys. It stands for Dynamic and Active Pixel Vision Sensor. Now they increase the resolution. It outputs both frames up to 24 hertz or on demand, and also the events in between. Here you see in slow motion how it works, and you will notice that the events are always ahead compared to the frames. So we did some preliminary work last year, where basically we extracted features like Harris corners from an object, from a frame, and then we track the features using only the event stream. So we do this event-based. And just to, I want to make you notice, basically the object was rotating at 1600 degrees a second, which means that the points of the star, the points of the ends of the star we're basically translating at more than 1800 pixels per second. And now actually observe that most state-of-the-art standard camera-based VO systems can cope with up to 30 or 50 pixels per second displacement when you use up to 5 to 6 level pyramid. Okay, so there is a huge potential also over here. So what do I think is that what we should do? Of course, I don't think that you should be using only DVSs, neither cameras alone, for any application. It all depends, of course, on the task and the application you want to solve. I think in general, for mobile robotics, we need a two-level sensing architecture composed of two layers, one that we call fast low latency level and a slow cognitive level. In the fast low latency level, what you want to do is that basically the agile behavior is obtained by a low latency control action that uses data from the fast sensor like the DVS and IMUs. And then you have a slow level where instead you try to solve tasks like SLAM or obstacle avoidance based on slower traditional sensors like cameras or lasers and so on. The sensor at the moment is pretty expensive. It costs about $5,000, especially more if you want to get 10, of course, then it becomes a huge thing. So what we did 2 months ago, we released the first event-based camera data set and simulator. It's done in Blender for SLAM in visual odometry. That basically, I hope, will allow you to basically start playing with the data. The data set contains a lot of data. It contains IMUs, frames, so this were collected with the Davis. So the Davis has also an embedded IMU. Remember, it also outputs frames. So you have IMUs, frames, events. We also recorded data from a motion capture system, and we have plenty of indoor and outdoor scenes with dynamic objects, also with slow motion and very high speed motion. This was published at IGRR, and you can find this on my webpage or here. So this brings me to the end of this talk. So the whole umbrella was towards agile flight. So where do we stand with respect to agile flight? So I think that agile flight of drones, like agile like birds, is still far away, probably 10 years from now. Because in principle, we need to be successful at perception, planning, and control. As I told you, a lot of perception and control have been studied separately, and I think there is a huge need of doing them jointly. Also, so basically try to do control to optimize perception, disambiguate perception ambiguities, you know, try to plan trajectories that favor the texture in the environment. But also then there is another point about standard cameras. Now, as you know, the theory of vision inertial odometry, visual SLAM is quite well understood. I think now the biggest challenge nowadays are reliability and robustness, especially against high dynamic range scenes, high speed motion, and low texture scenes. And I think that event cameras are really revolutionary and then open enormous possibilities. But of course, they're also very challenging because, you know, they require a significant paradigm shift with respect to the state of the art. But I hope I convinced you they are actually, you know, they open a potential for high-speed motion and high dynamic range scenes. And also, you know, they are intellectually very interesting because, you know, now computer vision has been studied for 50 years. I think it's also nice, you know, to work on new interesting challenges and new sensors. So I would like to thank all my guys that contributed, of course, to this research and also the sponsors and you for your attention. Thank you very much. And I would be happy to take questions if you have any.
Any questions? So what do you foresee for low texture environments? What kind of techniques would be useful there?
Structured light. Low texture, well, dense methods, they do a good job, but they are still costly. Structured light, in fact, if you think of the Intel RealSense, R200 or R300, they have a stereo as well as a projector, so it can also work with a uniform background. So I think this is the way also to go, not just standard camera, but also additionally active projection. Yeah. There?
What wavelength light does the sensor pick up? Is it only visible light?
It's like standard camera. So the photoreceptors are totally the same. So it's like standard cameras. I mean, you can remove the infrared cut filter and then you would also see a little bit in the infrared.
Okay.
It's the same. Currently, the pixels are slightly three times larger on X and Y than standard camera pixels. They are 18 micron rather than 6 microns. But now they are scaling this down, so they should be also soon also a version with smaller pixels. That means you collect also more light. Yes?
So, David, the one problem that for some of us who've been studying occlusion avoidance with passive vision is two things. One is, it's not just textureless environments versus textured environments, is that you need texture on everything that could come and eat your lunch, right? Mm-hmm. Every possible object needs to have optical texture, otherwise you don't see
right.
it.
Right, right, also for
that's
us.
One thing. The other thing is that often you have this problem of not having good, well-conditioned optical flow when you're going in the direction of your focus of expansion, right? Mm-hmm. So this is where the field is. I mean, you know, I was trying to see if there was some insight here that would tell us where any closer than to sort of solving this problem, which one is about dynamic range, the other one is about geometry, to solve this with without getting into semantics or anything else like this. Because I like the stuff, this is low level, but it still seems to be stuck on these
right.
problems.
Yeah, that's true. So yeah, we need also better dynamic range. Because in fact, we humans have a very good dynamic range. We can actually see, you know, the roughness of the wall that you wouldn't see with a standard camera. So we still need this. We also need better resolution, of course. For optical flow, I'm not sure I understood the question, but there also you need texture, right?
Right. I mean, you don't get much optic flow when you're moving in the direction of focus of expansion. There are people who we study thinking about moving the cameras to the axis of the camera is not the same as the direction of motion.
That's why.
So, I mean, of course, all the stuff that, for example, Mister did was always looking orthogonal to the direction of motion. Mm-hmm. Okay? And
yes.
You know what that problem is, that you can't do collision avoidance then. Right? You're looking sideways, and then it's very well conditioned, right? Or
right.
down.
Right.
So, the stuff when you're doing visual geometry works really well because your direction of motion is orthogonal.
It's down,
Yes.
Right, exactly. That's why we are doing this. And now, if you notice, all the drones, commercial drones, they do the same. They also have a camera for navigation pointing down. I agree. But I also think that the active vision can be helpful there, because when you have this, what I call the perceptual ambiguities. Like, you know, you're moving forward, so there is not much you can do. You cannot do structure from motion while moving forward. So you have to basically start slaloming a little bit in order to do that. You know, I think that's active vision is a key, to solve this. It's like also what pigeons do. Pigeons, you know, have eyes on the opposite size of the head, and therefore they are doing this motion back and forth in order to triangulate, right? So, I mean, active vision again, Yes?
With event-based cameras, in your experience, have you ever hit limits in terms of, like, too much texture?
Yeah.
Sort of overloading the pipeline?
Yeah.
And when does that happen?
Yeah. So, there is a buffer. Basically, it was at the same time you cannot have more than, if I remember, for 5,000 or 50,000 events at the same time. So there is a buffer that is get fooled, yes. And then you would actually observe a bar in the image that is all densely populated. But to be honest with you, this rarely happens. So we have hours of recording. We have a plot. I have a plot in other slides. We show the statistics, the event rate. In the average scene, it's never beyond 1 million events a second. So you will never saturate the buffer, unless you really go fast. So to saturate it, you have to put the DVS under a train, going at more than the fastest train speed, I would say, which is 200 kilometer hour. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes?
So this event-based sensor shipped out a list of addresses of pixels.
Correct. Address event representation, AER, correct. There's a standard, Right. Yes.
I thought the beginning part of the talk was interesting, where you gave an insight where you had really high frame rates, sparse land worked just as well as sort of semi-dense. Can you give an intuition behind that? Because I thought that was really interesting, like that point, but I didn't quite get the intuition behind why.
Do you mean this?
Yes.
So this is the convergence rate, number of poses out of 1,000 experiments that converge for a displacement that go from 0 to I don't know, like 100% of the image, so like the whole width of the image. You asked me for an intuitive.
Yeah, just I guess just an intuition behind why. So why they kind of, is it just because the distance between the frame rates, the distance between the frames gets so small that you don't need any more texture? Is that
well, it's because of this. Weak gradients are not informative for the optimization. Only large gradients are. And you know, when the overlap is very small, basically sparse versus dense or semi-dense is the same. Otherwise, they start to actually differentiate with each other. But semi-dense and dense, they will still remain more or less the same as long as, you know, because basically weak edges are not really informative enough for that. Does this answer?
Yeah.
And what I was saying besides that was that basically, you know, in most of the applications, if you use a very high-speed high frame rate cameras, like the ones we use on our drones, we trigger at 70 frames per second.
Yeah.
You know, depending on how close you are to the ground, we are never more than 1 meter closer anyway. Yeah, we are in this area.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Right, then let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you.